According to legend, Pritzker-winning architect Frank Gehry became mesmerized here in Sydney by its sandstone, its color, texture, and splendor. For here, in the heart of the city, colonial architect James Barnett's vision of classical genius stands as a testament to civic pride. Frank Gehry went away to sculpt his brown paper bags. But, despite being handed 180 million Australian dollars, this new civic institution could not afford sandstone. And so, he proposed this homage in brick. I came in like a wrecking ball. I never hit so hard. It is in some ways difficult to assess, or indeed logically understand, how one serves as the inspiration for the other. To quote Shakespeare, his building conjures up what we might lament as heavy lightness, serious vanity, misshapen chaos of well-seeming forms. Whilst its exterior is different and a momentary crowd-pleaser, if we accept that paying homage through innovation means merely difference and expensive, then architecture has genuinely been lost to the dark side. Despite being inspired by the classicism of Sydney, it seems that Gehry opted to ignore the arcades and colonnades of these civic buildings, refusing to allow his brick to open to the promenade in a welcoming and invitational gesture, opting instead for a cold, heartless, sharp edge from every entrance. Penetrating this icy barrier, what we can then find is another self-styled object of innovation. This stainless steel staircase. But it is here that the innovation disappears. In its place is a rectilinear service corps, his wavy walls hiding the same rectilinear programs and students are safely hidden away in the comfort of independent, air-conditioned study rooms without need for natural sun or light spring breeze. The architecture Gehry delivers thus fails to genuinely innovate space. It fails to challenge how students learn and engage in the complex socio-economic fabric of the 21st century. Lacking any experiential substance, what the building has delivered is a new mask to disguise 19th century classrooms clustered around this centralized, oval-shaped Victorian panopticon prison, creating an illusion of visual complexity and under the guise of innovation. The underlying question here is not whether the building should have been square, but rather raises the question of what we constitute to be good architecture. If we consider the building as a commodified object, then it could not have been more successful. UTS's fear of not being perceived as revolutionary and interesting has been safely masked by Gehry's iconic waves, complete with its $180 million price tag. What we have so far seen in the commodified capitalist 21st century world is that architecture has been lost to the allure of the Gehry brand, and, as Carrie Bradshaw puts it to us in Sex and the City, the choice is between labels and love.
Whilst the celebration of the superfluous may in fact be unintentionally symbolic for a school of business, it does little to further the dignity of a meaningful and substantial architecture. If we can instead try to accept that there is more to architecture than merely corporate branding, then the Geary Building represents not an innovation in architecture, but a sorely missed opportunity. What is being neglected is the civic role which an education building plays in the stitching and weaving of the urban fabric. If we cannot take anything positive from Geary's paper bags, then at least we can pass by Ultimo and reminisce over the mistakes of his architecture. Firstly, that complexity for the sake of complexity is not equal to innovation. That architecture is about spatial experience, not merely intrigue. And finally, that architecture possesses a civic role and should address the city meaningfully. Set alongside this melancholy story of Australia's new sacrilegious sculpture, now sadly cemented into Ultimo's urban fabric, we can always dream that architecture would have never died, and that Frank Geary would have been more forgiving.
Skin.